My name is Chris Vickers. I've been investigating the paranormal for 3 years.
My name is George Franco Mihalos. I've been investigating in the paranormal field now for about 5 years.
My name is Ryan Fessler, and I have been investigating the paranormal for approximately 4 years.
My name is Carolyn Braban, and I've been a paranormal investigator for about 3 years.
My name is Brian Turnoff, and I've been investigating the paranormal for 3 years.
My name is Phil Picardi. I've been investigating for just about under a year.
Being a paranormal investigator means to me is finding the truth.
You know, I don't do this for fame. I don't do this for money. I do this to help others.
That word, paranormal investigator, means responsibility.
It means putting the client first and being able to establish whether a spirit is actually in their homes or not.
Being a paranormal investigator means to me going out and helping someone who needs help that doesn't have explained answers.
My top three favorite places to investigate: number one, Gettysburg, PA; number two, Sac de Coast Manor, Long Island; number three, Mount Misery.
My top three places that I've investigated would be number one, Bobby Mackey's, Wilder, Kentucky; number two, Mount Misery Road in Long Island, New York; and number three, Kings Park Psych Center.
Top three favorite places to investigate would have to be the Fire Island Lighthouse, Kings Park Psych Center, and Sac de Coast Manor, all located on Long Island.
Best piece of evidence I've gotten has to be at Burlington Prison.
He had a strobe light set up outside the room.
I started to recreate if a prisoner were to get hurt.
And he said, "Guard, guard, help us, we're down."
All of a sudden, the strobe light kicks on. It starts going off by itself.
No one was near it, and it happened several times throughout the night.
They turned into just like balls of energy and shot across the ceiling.
Look up, I see a black figure come down the stairwell in the hallway.
Couldn't really tell what it was, but definitely wasn't there at the time.
My favorite piece of equipment would be any Geiger counter.
Audio recorder,
the air ion counter.
I think I'm both scientific and spiritual.
Definitely more on the scientific side.
I'm going to have to consider myself more of a spiritual investigator.
Always try to take a scientific approach. It takes a lot for me to be convinced of anything.
I use my equipment and I stick to my equipment, but you also go off your intuition. If you're feeling something, roll with it.
Hey, what up? It's Cyrus from Newfound Glory. I want to say what up to Chris and Shadows of the Paranormal. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Bobby Mackey, and I'd certainly like to welcome my friends here from Long Island, the SOB Group.
Hey, this is Aaron Houdini, and I'm here with Shadows of the Paranormal at Bobby Mackey's Music World. I want to give Shadows a big shout out.
Hey guys, this is SOP, Misguided Souls. We'll be back in one moment.
The views expressed and opinions given by the individual hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of ZTalk Radio, its affiliates, or sponsors.
Good evening, everyone. This is Misguided Souls with Shadows of the Paranormal. What's happening?
Yo.
What's up?
Hi.
So tonight we have a cool guest tonight. Ben Hansen.
Ben Hansen.
He's from Sci-Fi.
Tall. He's famous.
Yes. We got a chance to meet Ben when we were in Phenomenology in Gettysburg this past year.
Awesome guy.
And that was the thing, like, you know, we were all talking to all, you know, other people that were there, and a lot of people were like, oh, you know, I wonder how, when Ben Hansen gets here, how he's going to be, because, you know, he's on a major network and this and that. And he was just really, like, down to earth.
Yeah, really cool.
Very humble, very laid back, and I know that you know, George, you guys were talking for a while too, and you went over there as well.
Yeah.
And you guys were talking for a while.
Yeah.
And it was pretty cool. And Brian's been having contact with him back and forth.
Yeah, we've been talking, just setting everything up. He's a really nice guy. You know, he's obviously has an extremely busy schedule, and for him to take time out of his day while he's pretty much going to be on the road is, you know, I think that's, you know, almost an honor for us, really. You know, so taking
really
time
cool.
out of his day. Really has no reason to do this, but he's a nice guy, like we all said, and this just kind of proves it more than anything. So, I mean, it should be a pretty great show tonight. He should be calling in around 7:10, 7:15, so expect him around then. It's going to be a good show. We're going to ask him a ton of stuff. We'll find out about the new season. You know, we'll talk about his investigative experiences, some of his, you know, and whatever else pretty much comes to mind.
Yeah, any new events that's coming up that he's going to.
Right. So you should, you know him from, you know, Ben Hansen, television host, Fact or Fiction, Paranormal Files. If you guys want a chance to ask Ben a question, you guys are already listening, just go back to the ztalkradio.com homepage and click the listen in chat. And if we get some good questions, we'll definitely try and ask them if we get a chance.
Yeah.
So it should be a great show. More information on our group, you guys know what to do. Facebook.com/Shadows of the Paranormal. ShadowsTheParanormal.com. If you're listening, you probably already think we're awesome, so we appreciate it. And
most people do when they meet us.
Yeah. So it should be a good show.
And we have some guests in our room, too.
Yes, we do.
Yeah, we do.
We should introduce them. Go ahead and introduce them.
I'm Brittany. I actually won this investigation through a cancer benefit from my friend, so I'm very excited to be with you guys, and it is my first investigation. So hope all is well.
And I'm Rich, and this is my first investigation. We've done some cemeteries together, but nothing big, so I'm excited.
Okay, cool. Yeah, after the radio show, we're going to pick out two locations and take them out on an investigation. Yeah, we're not going to say where. We'll update you guys next Monday. We got to have a reason for you guys to come back.
We can tell you.
Well, you can give you the history of it.
Yeah.
So, but, you know, for those who are listening in the chat room as well, you know, the two guests that we do have in the room were from the Hope Matters benefit that you guys have listened to as well, that we have talked about for a while. So, you know, it's definitely an honor to be a part of that that benefit and to, you know, see so much money raised for such a, you know, good cause trying to, you know, help out. So, I mean, that's what it's all about, is helping people. So,
either, you know, in any way we could.
Exactly. So, I mean, that was hectic too. It was back to back.
Yeah.
It was driving straight from Syracuse.
Oh my God. Yeah, 5.5 hours and right to Katie's, and
it was awesome. It was a good time though.
It was awesome. We ran into Matt. Matt was there for about 3 hours.
Yeah, I got there at 3. You guys got there at like 6.
Matt was already all smiles. Man.
I already had a couple of drinks by the time you guys got there.
Yeah.
I didn't think you guys were coming. Yeah. I thought you guys were still going to be driving back. So
traffic.
It was a good surprise.
Yeah, as Phil would say, "What's wrong with you?"
Yeah.
No.
What's wrong with you?
Man, you don't understand.
You don't understand.
Definitely. But you know, we have some photos that were uploaded from Syracuse and from Hope Matters on our Facebook page on our website, we do have some things that are coming up. We have some local festivities we're going to be partaking in.
So our New York listeners, you know, listen up right now. You're gonna get a chance to meet us if you want to come out, say what's up, and, you know, talk a little bit more. We're going to be at Fright Fest. That's in Mastic Beach, New York. It's in Eastern Long Island, Suffolk County. Not really too far from the city, you know, 40 miles or so. You know, we're close to Westchester. It's going to be a really cool, local feel festival, and
right,
you know,
it's Halloween
related. So bring the kids, family, you know, friendly and all that stuff. So we'll be there, I think, from about 10 to 5 or 12 to 5, and that's on October 13th,
yep.
Saturday. So Mastic Beach, you know, we'll give you some more info next week or, you know, the week beforehand just to remind you.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, just give us a shout if you guys, you know, need anything or whatever. And if you guys have any events in your area, or if you know local events that maybe we haven't talked about or we're not sure of, me and Ryan hit up an event this weekend. It was a fall fair in Lake Ronkonkoma, and
in the parking lot.
Yeah, it was it wasn't bad. It was interesting. But you know, we have that going on. Then next month, where Carolyn and Matt used to work, I'm going to be displaying some of my photos at the Cup Coffee House.
It's in Wanta, New York. If you guys want to come down.
Maybe a little more information.
Yeah, it's right by the train station. It's on
Railroad Avenue in Wanta, New York.
3268 Railroad Avenue.
Look at that.
Yeah.
In Wanta. Really, really awesome coffee house.
Famous people go there.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's right by the train station. So you get off the train, get some coffee, meet us.
Do I need a beanie hat?
Chris's
work. I need a beanie hat to go in
Matt.
No.
To work there, you do. But Matt.
Yeah, to work there.
As a patron.
Matt's always down there, and you were there the other day, and Chris stopped by. The drummer Bayside.
Yeah, Chris from Bayside, we know him. And
Daryl Palumbo goes down there often. Singer Glassjaw and Head Automatica.
And Dee Snider, didn't he used to live?
He lived on top of the
upstairs.
The apartment upstairs, yeah.
Yeah, I remember the owner used to tell me, the owner at the time used to tell me, he's like, he always wore really weird shoes. I just always noticed that. And I was like, okay.
Was she 80 years old also?
He was like 80, yeah. He was really old.
They didn't notice the fishnet stockings.
No,
or,
he's like, just the
blush.
Shoes and like, yeah.
But,
just the shoes.
That's what Phil would notice. Phil
absolutely
would notice the shoes.
Absolutely.
And his pants.
Get that right.
But
well, those bleeds.
D-Side is an awesome person too, and I got a chance to hang out with him a few months back, and I've been in contact with his agent about doing some events together, and I know that he's in the works in another autism charity event, so that's something that we would love to get back into is helping back out with some other charities as well. It's local. They're going to be doing it at Westbury Music Fair. It's right down the block from you guys.
Awesome.
Yeah. Oh,
wow. Don't have to travel far. Yes.
Yeah.
Finally.
But I can't wait to hear back from that and get a little bit more information. So, but
very good. Very good.
Yes.
I wonder if he's going to be doing the autism walk next weekend at Jones Beach.
Maybe.
There was the Battery Tunnel run yesterday in Manhattan.
Oh, there we go.
Is that him?
It's,
let's see.
Hopefully it's him.
I'm trying to call it. I don't know. Hello?
Dancer.
Yep. Hey, Ben, what's going on? It's Chris.
Hey, Chris. So, did I call at the right time?
Oh, perfect.
Yes, you did.
You got it.
Welcome.
Okay.
Perfect timing. Thank you so much for coming on, and we really appreciate taking time out of your day, to come on here with us.
You're welcome.
We know it was recently your birthday, so on behalf of SOP, we just want to say happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
And what'd you end up doing for your birthday?
I was driving back from Vegas from an event, so I really didn't do anything.
I guess you're probably pretty spent from Vegas, I would imagine.
It was a UFO lecture, so it was just basically kind of sitting around. I wasn't actually lecturing.
Very cool.
That worked. So where are you at now?
I'm back in Southern California. Just enjoying the heat out here.
Yeah.
It's getting colder. It's getting colder here in New York, man. So you're better
off in
Southern
New York or yet?
Long Island.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't look forward to the winter.
No.
So I have a question I've been dying to ask you, actually. I hear you're somewhat of a pretty big X-Files fan. What's your favorite Monster of the Week episode?
I kind of like the one where I can't remember the lake that it was. I think it was supposed to be kind of like the Ogre Pogo monster that took Scully's dog.
Scully's dog.
You remember that one? Where she took it for a walk. I forget the dog's name. Something after, named it after Moby Dick, some character, and she took the dog out and it snatched the dog and ate it.
Oh, God.
Yeah, it's pretty memorable scene.
Sparky, no.
I love the one with the incest family. That one just for whatever reason, that incest family
right,
one just,
where they're living underneath the bed, like the mom.
Yeah, that one just has stayed with me for about 15 years. I don't know why, but that one just, I can't get it out of my head.
That's right. That was a good one too. She had no arms or legs, and she was on a skateboard or something.
But on a serious note, I guess you got how to go from X-Files to serious, but you're a former FBI agent, criminal investigator. What skills and techniques, strategies did you learn, criminally investigating that you think has been the most helpful or applicable investigating paranormally?
I normally tell people, especially UFO cases, they're not as active, they're historic. But even ghost assigning cases, a lot of what we do is interviewing, and sometimes that's all you have. You don't have a video or photo, and so interviewing people is where you get your best information, especially if you suspect that they may have hoaxed something. Those skills, I always tell people, I know it's kind of hard. There's not really a lot of places out there to teach forensic interviewing technique, but there are some good books. And for people to work on those skills, because it's not really intuitive, you know, like you might think. There are some things you have to be consciously aware of, and getting those skills down is probably the most crucial thing you can do in an investigation.
So with skills, you mean like having a tell, like being able to tell if somebody is lying or telling the truth? Is that basically?
Yeah, exactly. There's deception techniques. A lot of, you know, paying attention to nonverbal cues, but also a lot of, you know, people are not they're not kind of like by nature good listeners, and that's a skill that you need to learn, because a lot of you know, listening to people in interviews, I've noticed even with my own team, who that's not their strength, they cut people off. And sometimes, like, the best build that you get from someone, or they're about ready to tell you something important, gets cut off, or they subconsciously leave it kind of hanging out there when they really want you to explore it more, but you don't follow up with questions. So There's a lot of that stuff. There's a time and a place to call people out with inconsistent information, you know, and it's like a fine line of tact, especially if somebody calls you in, you know, to do an investigation to help them out, you know, like, it's not like a criminal case. It is different in that sense, because you can't have a threat of jail time, you know, hanging over their head to cooperate, and you don't want to come off that way. So, I mean, there's obvious differences, but the interview is where it all starts. All the experiments and all that, the limit is really set on, you know, what kind of money you have to work with.
Would you say usually when you're interviewing people in this field, say for a haunting investigation or something to that effect, would you say that most of the time when you're interviewing them, you pick up on something maybe that they're not being completely honest about? Or would you say it's about 50-50, or like, did you have some type of percentage you could give?
Well, I'd say more than half the cases end up being explained, but of the unexplained, or I'm sorry, of the explained ones, I would say most people are honest.
Okay.
I mean, we've run into more and more hoaxes, but it's more so that there's like just parts of it that they're not being completely truthful about because of one reason or another. It's hard to say. I mean, because we screen a lot of the stuff by you know, not doing full-on backgrounds, but kind of grilling the people on the phone before we take cases, and we don't. We wouldn't have a show if we didn't have anybody hoaxing anything.
Yeah,
but at the same time, we don't want to go out on something that we know that is a known hoax. If they've admitted to us, you know, that it was a hoax, we can't go out on it.
Yeah.
But yet there's some of them where you think there's a pretty good idea, you know how they did it, and you're just kind of waiting to call them out on it. And those ones are kind of fun too, because when you can present them with some known facts, it's interesting to see how liars, you know, respond.
Yeah. Now, how do you guys feel? Like, I mean, let's say you take time, you know, you take time out, you travel to, let's say, across the country, and just to find out that somebody was completely lying to you. I mean, how do you guys handle that really professionally? And you know, how do you guys handle that so well?
Well, if it was on my own dime, I think I'd be pretty upset.
Yeah.
Since, you know, the show is paying for it, and if you end up in a place like Australia and you happen to go looking for a mermaid on the Great Barrier Reef, you're not too upset. It doesn't turn out to be a real mermaid. But, yeah, obviously to advance the knowledge in a particular field, there have been some cases where I really wanted it to be true. And I would say in those particular cases, it was more so not that we found a hoax, but we found the explanation for it.
Yeah, right.
And it's not really their fault, you know, because some people, even they kind of know in the back of their mind, they think they know what it is, but for whatever reason, they want to be on TV or something like that, they just kind of embellish.
Yeah.
You right. know, so it's, you know, disappointing because I don't like when people, you know, they tune into our show and they're like, oh, no, another one explained. You know, this is no fun. That really falls into line with what it is in real life.
Yeah.
You know, 95% of UFO cases, if you were doing this as a MUFON investigator or whatever, are explained.
Yeah.
And with hauntings, I don't know. I find most places that people say have activity does seem to have some type of activity, but when they present physical evidence, like videos and photos, most of those are, you know, explained as some kind of
dust.
That's what I'm looking for. Yeah, like paranormal explanation.
Now, one of my favorite cases, and I talked to you in Gettysburg about this, was when you guys went to Waverly. You had a pretty cool experience, and I was wondering if you could just share that with the show. And I mean, I don't know if you guys were able to really come up with an explanation for that, were you?
No, you know, and like I always tell people, like when I had heard of the most active locations, you know, that maybe Ghost Hunters has gone to, I think either Chris or Amy or somebody had said that, you know, Waverly was the top of their list, and so I was really excited. But to be honest, when I first got there, like the whole night and the whole time we were there, nothing happened. Like there was absolutely no activity except for a period of about 15 minutes when everything seemed to start happening at once.
Yeah.
There was a rainstorm. And it was kind of windy and everything outside, and it just kind of started up, and I was down in the body chute. And, you know, as I was down there, I could hear you've been there before, obviously.
Actually, I haven't, no.
Oh, okay. I thought you were speaking from having been there, but...
Oh, no, no.
There's some drainage, they're like... I don't know the drainage areas, but well, maybe they are. Like above your head in the tunnels, there's these open areas that have kind of open up into the outside. So I could hear wind and stuff blowing, but you can tell what is the sounds that are being created in the tunnel as opposed to outside.
Right.
And I sat down and started doing an EVP session, and my flashlights were turning on and off, corresponding to questions. My EMF meter was going crazy. And then I heard somebody walking down that long hallway, the body chute. And it was unmistakable. It was so loud that I thought that one of our crew had wandered down and was trying to sort of be quiet, but they didn't know we were filming.
Right.
So... I yelled out to him, I said, who's up there? You know, kind of like, identify yourself, what's going on? And there was no response. And then it sounded as if a piece of metal had clanked against the wall, like maybe the gate at the top of the thing had banged into the wall. And, you know, by that time, I was kind of getting pissed.
Yeah.
And so I ran to the top of the thing, turned the corner, and there was nobody there. So even if it had been someone who had wandered down, there's two long hallways that kind of intersect, and they're long enough that if I ran up that tunnel and turned, you would have seen the other person still running up the other tunnel. So there was nobody there. So it was really cool, and then all that was going on when our cameras, you know, caught the ball that was moving up on the fourth floor, and you know, that to me is baffling as well, because there is a part where the ball turns.
Yep.
And I'm not quite sure if it bumped into the door jamb and it just happened to roll, or if it actually takes a right angle turn.
Yeah.
So, you know, all this stuff was happening all at the same time, and I've been to a few places like that where nothing happens and then all comes down at once.
Mm-hmm. And that's funny, because that's usually how, like, paranormal investigations go, especially when you're looking for, you know, spirits or... A lot of times nothing's happened, like you said, you know, it'll be really quiet and a lot of things are explainable. But when something does happen, it happens pretty fast, and sometimes you'll get a lot of things happening at once. So it could be pretty wild, just like what you experienced. And I thought it was awesome, and I definitely want, you know, thank you for sharing that on our show, by the way, with everybody.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was quite the experience, and I definitely want to go back there. I've been in Kentucky so many times in the past year, but I'm surprised I haven't gone, you know, through Waverly again to investigate it.
Yeah, definitely put that on the list.
Now, out of the places that you've gone, Tombstone, USS North Carolina, Waverly, you've gone all over the place. You've gone to UK and Australia. What would you say would be, like, your most, like, memorable, your favorite place? And, you know, like we were saying before, is, like, if you had to do it on your own dime, where would be the place that you want to go again?
Wow. There's so many different favorites for different reasons. You know, like, as far as, like, the most active locations, I would say probably Battleship North Carolina and Tombstone. Both of them, we had object manipulation, and not just kind of like, you know, on the battleship, something knocked over our motion sensor, but it also picked up our camera and chucked it.
Wow.
And the same thing with Tombstone, something picked up our IR light, ripped it off of a door where it was duct taped, and chucked it down the hall. It's so frustrating, too, because it's as if, and I understand skeptics looking at that and saying, oh, yeah, how convenient. You're just outside your camera range, and I get it. I would say the same thing. But it's as if whoever's doing this really has a good sense of where the cameras are, you know, and has some understanding, because things... typically, at least for me, tend to happen just around the corner or just behind you or, you know, in the other room. And very rarely do you catch something like that on camera. And we have caught a few things, but those places were just, in between filming, we had a lot of things being slammed. You know, in Battleship North Carolina, I had one of the big serving trays in the kitchen where they heat the food up, the stainless steel tray. I was just making a comment. I wasn't being disrespectful, but I was making a comment about the soldier who had fallen down that well and died. And right behind me, one of those big lids was lifted up and slammed back down. And, you know, we weren't filming. We turned around and, you know, who did that? Who's around here? And all the crew was, like, really far away from it. and those things just don't happen by themselves.
Yeah.
So I would say I'd like to go back probably to both of those places as far as, you know, ghost investigations go.
How does the crew, like, react to something like that off camera? Are they freaked out, or do they handle it all right?
Very good responses. We got one of our guys, a camera guy, Jake, and Jake will be the first one to tell you that he doesn't really believe in that stuff. You know, he'll, at the end of the night, he's winding up cables and going around and picking up cameras and stuff, you know, doing things that I think if I felt like him, yeah, it would be easier to just wander into these places all by yourself all the time. But when he's been there, when some of this stuff has happened, it's interesting because it's more so like, yeah, that was interesting. I can't explain it. instead of, whoa, okay, you know, now I'm starting to believe what everyone's been saying. Yeah. You know, and it's just kind of an interesting attitude. I don't know. That's kind of the thing with a few of our guys. Another director of photography, great guy. He's not so much, you know, jittery about the ghost stuff, but anything we do that's cryptozoological.
We may have lost him.
No.
Did the phone die?
Nope.
Okay.
He was breaking up a little bit.
He was yeah. I think he was on the road, so he, you know, obviously when you're driving,
truck. Yeah.
Throwing in the reception.
That was gonna be a good story too.
I
just had an awesome question coming up.
Save it. We're still on the air, I think.
Yeah, we still are. Wait, what you know?
So
everybody listening, would you like to hear a song and dance in the meantime?
Well, you can't hear the dance, but you
can hear the dance if you step loud enough.
Ryan's got a couple years of tap under his belt.
But he's a cool guy.
I mean, unfortunately, sometimes you have technical difficulties. Yes. It's just the technology that we work with.
You started breaking up, and then we just lost you. That's all right. You're a cryptozoology guy?
So a cameraman, I was talking about the Honey Island Swamp Monster and how he's more jittery about creatures, things of that sort. You know, and he wouldn't get out of the boat. I heard some crashing through the woods. I was like, come on, let's go, and he wouldn't follow me in there. Trying to make TV here and trying to, you know, follow what we came there to find, and there was something heavy walking around, you know, and he said, oh, no, there's going to be an alligator, this or that, and I'm like, I guess I just don't really feel the same sense of danger.
Yeah.
You know, because I think if it's a creature that's an alligator, it's going to run away from me rather than wait and attack me, but I don't know, it's kind of funny that we tease him about that.
Yeah, I'm always afraid of the real stuff, like a homeless guy coming out of the middle of the woods, like, you know, with a knife, you know, that's the type of stuff that scares me. It's not, you know, Bigfoot or anything like that. But, you know, as you're doing paranormal research, you know, you kind of, and you're going to all these different type of places, you kind of just become a history buff in a way, and then one place, you know, you go to one place, you find out about it, it leads to something else, and you're always kind of doing personal research into, you know, history that you like, places that you've been. You know, you guys obviously do paranormal files. What's the, like, you know, most convincing historical paranormal file that you've researched or that you think is, like, the most convincing it actually happened? You know, in Roswell, Bigfoot, you know, Christopher Columbus seeing a UFO, whatever, you know, whatever you've researched. What do you think is the most convincing historically?
I think for the sheer number of documents and research that's been done, and we haven't done it on the show, but with the Roswell case, I'm pretty thoroughly convinced that whatever crashed there, I mean, the government gave four different explanations. So, you know, you can choose one of those that you like, or you can go with what the research indicates, that something did crash that was, at least we can definitively say it was not conventional. When you get into the stories of the bodies, you know, I've talked to people whose own fathers were, you know, at the air bases where the debris was taken, and no reason to lie to their own kids on their deathbeds, and there's several of these, you know, where they've described that they were not human or not, you know, what we would describe as human. You know, one was alive, one was dead. So, I don't know. I mean, if you take into account all that, I would say that's a very convincing story. And the same with, you know, we did do the battle over Los Angeles case. And I would say, again, there's no way of telling what was in the air. But there definitely was something. I find it hard to believe that they shot 1,400 rounds of ammunition at nothing. Hmm. You know, and they describe it as war nerves and young soldiers just being nervous because Pearl Harbor was recent. You know, I find that difficult to believe. And we've done a couple other historic cases, but those, I think, are probably the most convincing to me.
What did they do with the live alien? That was, you said that they found one, that alien that was dead from Roswell, and one was alive. What did you find out what they did with the alien?
No, I mean, according to this particular source, he told his kid that there was one that was that they saw that was dead, and the other was writhing on the floor. And they said that, I'm trying to remember if it was that one or the one that had died, they said that they killed it on accident. And he was led to believe that it was more so because of the experiments they were doing that it died. I mean, well, from there you can get into the legends of, if that's not weird enough.
Yeah.
Super weird of one of these aliens being assigned a caretaker to a guy in New Mexico. You know, like, he was like the Air Force's, you know, kind of the witness relocation program or something, to where he lived with the guy in seclusion or something like that for many years. And I don't know. I mean, I can't just dismiss these things because I don't want people to just dismiss other things, you know, without looking into it.
Yeah.
But, I mean, there's less evidence to support any of that. But what we do know is that, yes, something that was not ours crashed in the desert. It's not one, but two different objects at least. And it's, you know, the hundreds of people they were able to interview before they died, it would all point to suggest that, yeah, I mean, if you took that to a trial and presented the evidence, it would be overwhelming.
Do they ever give, or anybody ever give, some type of theory on why it crashed? Whatever, if it was an alien craft or a...
Yeah, there's a few theories. The predominant one, I'd probably say there's two predominant theories. There was a thunderstorm during that weekend. It's reported that it was kind of a, not a huge, but kind of a rogue thunderstorm. And it's possible that we've seen other crashes like this, that it was actually struck by lightning. And it kind of scrambled the propulsion system signals, whatever it needed to, that brought it down. And, you know, understandably, people say, well, they come whatever, you know, so many light years away, and they didn't prepare for that. I mean, they get struck by lightning all the time. But the other theory is that we shot it down, and that we had just really come into, you know, this was the atomic age, and we just really had just gained the capability of firing missiles. We could bring something that quick, you know, down from the sky. And so those are the two theories.
That one definitely seems more feasible, the latter one. So what can we, you know, so what's going on with the next season of, you know, Fact or Fiction? Are you guys filming, or like, what's the plan?
No, we're not filming. And we've heard some rumors, and we're just kind of waiting on pins and needles, because Sci-Fi is kind of rearranging their schedule and the jobs they've had, and we have been told, though, that if they pick us up for another season or half season, we'd probably be in production really quickly, because I think they were aiming at having us back on in the spring. You know, and so it takes several months just to film, and then editing and all that stuff. So I think kind of a time frame we're looking at, if we heard within the next couple of weeks, we'd probably be filming, I would guess, beginning of November. Probably, you know, through the holidays, and we'd probably be on maybe around March or something, I'm just guessing. But yeah, we still need to get picked up by the network for the new season.
And now to bring up another cool point about the show I actually wanted to ask before, I guess I'm a little different from most people who watch the shows. I love it when you guys disprove stuff. And there were two cases in particular that I like to bring up, and for some reason I saw the episodes a long time ago, and I can't remember the actual locations, but there's one, I believe it was a Midwest cemetery, where the original footage was of a white mist walking through the cemetery, and there's a highway next to it, and you guys figured out that it was actually a lens flare from the highway that had caused the figure, and you guys had actually recreated it perfectly, and it was rather incredible because when you guys recreated it, it looked like a figure, a white figure walking through the cemetery.
Yeah, that one kind of blew me away, too. I think that was Tonopah Cemetery, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of times, too, when we have these experiments that you got to remember, some of them, when they're really extraordinary, like just outlandish, there's a lot of our ideas. A lot of these are presented by, you know, the viewers, and we do them just, you know, in spite to show people how ridiculous that might be. And anyways, even when we do the ridiculous ones,
yeah,
I'm very surprised at how much they look like the original video in some cases. You know, so in that particular case, I didn't see how a lens flare could have done that until they did the experiment.
It was rather incredible. It's funny because
it's a good lesson for all of us. You don't.
Yeah.
Not all the things we do are really expensive. You know, I was in Stanley Hotel, and I was leading a group for Ghost Investigation, and we were in room 317, where, you know, Stephen King wrote first part of The Shining, and we were all taking pictures in there, and somebody had their camera. They were sitting on the floor, and they kept getting these pictures with these red lights, like that were streaking across the top of the photo and everything, and she showed me how she was angling her camera, and we tried to recreate it right then, and what we would do is we would just start covering up the mirrors in the room in different parts, you know, with towels or sheets or anything we could find to see if there was any light refraction, and I still don't know how I did it, but you gotta remember, cameras, inside of them, the lenses have a series of mirrors, lenses, and glass that refract things, and I still don't know how it does it, but we were able to show how it was a part of a mirror that was reflecting and refracting this red light because of the red light that was on one of their I can't remember if it was a K2 or something that was in the room. You know, it's just so strange, but those things can happen. Light can bend at very strange angles. And I tell people, if you find something in your photo when you get home, probably 9 times out of 10, if you didn't notice it there, or unless you're dealing with something, you know, that's, you know, invisible to the naked eye, unless you didn't notice it, it probably is just an artifact of the camera.
Right.
And you really should look at your pictures while you're there and really study them. If you find anything, the best time to recreate it is when the conditions are exactly the same, and just try to recreate it while you're there.
Right. And to bring up one more case that I thought was... I have to bring it up. These two cases I thought were incredible, because it involves a piece of equipment that every team wants. There was another case, and once again, forgive me, I'm forgetting the name of the location, but the original footage was a paranormal team had gone into a building location, and they were using a thermal imager. And they had looked down the hallway, and they had got a hit that was shaped almost like a human torso down at the end of the hallway. And you guys debunked it as the range on the thermal imager was not sufficient enough to cover the whole hallway, and it just turned out to be something else that was distorted at the end of the hallway. And I bring that up because, you know, most paranormal teams would love to get their hands on a thermal imager, and even the cheap ones are like $1,500.
Was that the Florida Theater?
Maybe. I forget the name of it.
I think you were talking about it was a bar, wasn't it? In, forget that way, because I wasn't on it. It was in the hallway, though, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was a bar, and they were looking down the hallway. Maybe that was the same episode as the shattering ashtray.
Right.
Maybe not.
Yeah, it was. I wish I remember the name of the place. It was a hallway, and I remember there was some kind of hit at the end of the hallway that looked like a human torso, and it turned out to be something else giving off heat that was distorted because
that may be in Jersey Shore, I think.
But I, you know, like I said, I bring it up because it's something that a lot of paranormal teams would love to get, even if it's the cheap ones, and that's something that I think every team should realize. You really need to know your equipment, because if you start running around showing people, oh my god, look at this evidence, and it's, you know, it may not, you know, be actually what you're looking at. You just need to know how to use your stuff.
You really do, and you kind of have to go out and try to make anomalies with it, you know, because when you first use a FLIR, you realize that it picks up reflections on any shiny surface.
Right.
Any glass, anything, you'll see yourself. And that's kind of freaky, because if you got your eyes glued to the screen of it, you're walking down a hall, all of a sudden you see a figure walking towards you.
Yeah.
You know, you realize, it's a window.
Right.
That you're looking at. But they do have, FLIR does teach and certify people now in, it's not meant for the ghost hunting, but for heat detection and using their equipment.
Wow.
You know, so I know somebody who took some training from them so that they know how to set the different ranges on it, they know what to look for, and all that stuff.
It's pretty amazing, and that's why I think I like your show a lot more, actually, and I'm not a huge show person, you know, I like to figure things out as much as I can on my own, but I think that's why I have probably the most respect for your show, because of the extent to which you guys do go to figure things out, and there are a lot of learning sessions that you guys really give through your show.
Oh, so. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, there's a lot of times...
I've succeeded a little bit, I guess.
Well, there's a lot of times when, you know, where, you know, I'll be watching a show and I'm like, how the hell are they even thinking of doing it? You know what I mean? Like, the ideas that you guys come up with, and I'm like, I would never even thought of that. And it's cool because, you know, the team that you have that, you know, put together, you can really tell that everyone does their research and everyone does their homework.
Well, thank you. Yeah, I mean, we're not alone either. We have a whole research team who vets a lot of these videos because we're filming constantly, and so we'll go back and forth with them and see what they've got, and the same thing with the experiments. You know, so we do have a lot of talented people, but it's funny, if you sit on one of those meetings where we're tossing out ideas, you know, and some of the ones that we think are ridiculous, that we end up doing, you know, surprisingly, you know, come close to it, like I said.
So now, when you guys get, like an urban legend or some type of case request, is it how the, you know, like how television portrays, is it you guys going through them and deciding what you want to do? Or a lot of it, is it sci-fi that's like, you know what, I think you guys should check these ones out?
We have had a few from sci-fi where they've said, look, this is a cool topic. You know, maybe you can find something in this area. And we've had, you know, like, they do audience panel surveys all the time. You know, they decide, you know, like, do people like more UFOs? Do they like more ghost stuff? And so we do kind of search in those particular areas if we need more of one or another. So, yeah, everybody kind of is in the kitchen, you know, kind of guiding as to what they want us to find. But we all participate in it. You know, like, I get stuff sent to me all the time directly, and I found a couple of cases, even from conventions I've been at, where, you know, someone has come up to me and said, look, there's this lady in the UK, she's got this amazing video, she's a friend of mine, she hasn't told anyone about it really, and then I get in touch with that person, and then we fly out there and we do the case. And then some of them come in through the website itself, but I found that most of the people who actually come to us and submit, there's a higher proportion of them that are going to be turn out to be fake rather than us going out and finding them. You know, because, and I would expect that too. If I had something really good, to be honest with you, I mean, there's a lot of silly TV out there.
Yeah.
We're kind of afraid to put it out there so that, you know, people will just ridicule it or this or that. And I think we've developed a pretty good reputation that even people who are worried that we might ultimately debunk their video, they trust that, hey, if it can survive this, you know, like these guys will give me a fair shake with it. So they'll still come to us and submit it.
Absolutely.
Definitely. One of the listeners that we have in our chat room actually got a chance to investigate with you at the First Ward Schoolhouse in Wisconsin.
Oh, yeah.
And Jenny, she's in our chat room, and she wanted us to just, you know, let you know that she says hello.
Yeah, we've been reviewing some of their EVPs that they caught today, and some pretty cool stuff. There's one where this is a schoolhouse, and there's I was making some comments about punishment, you know, the kids, because nothing was really happening. I was talking about punishment and paddles, and when you hear the EVP, there's these kids. It sounds like a kid's voice who almost is kind of like, no.
It's funny. She goes, I won't be surprised if he calls me Big Mouth Jenny.
Big Mouth Jenny?
Yes. But we have a few minutes left. We actually have two guests here tonight as well, Ben, that we had a local paranormal team. One of the fathers was diagnosed with colon cancer, and we had given up to a charity and, you know, put a basket together as a raffle. And we have the winner of our raffle basket here, and we're actually going to, after this phone call, we're going to be doing an investigation. And she just had a question for you.
Uh-huh.
On the show, when you guys go over the cases and you decide which ones you want to investigate, are there any cases that you want to investigate that you don't air on the show, but you still go to anyway and investigate?
Yeah, that happens. None that have we've passed over that I've gone to investigate on my own time, not quite yet. But, I mean, there was one case that we passed over, at least one in Florida for the David Eckhart case, and we brought that back and reconsidered it, because there's sometimes in one episode where we'll have a lot of good ones, you know, all at once, and each one of those, we've gotten to the point where we know that we can at least do a case on it. So just because we shelf it, you know, doesn't mean that we won't come back to it later. And then I've got some cases that don't make it onto the show because it's a very strict criteria. Because we have to have video evidence or a photo is the format of the show right now. And so I've gone out to locations that I've wanted to, and I'm planning some other trips. I have nothing to do with the show, but I do this type of thing because, you know, I really, you know, either want to tell the world about it or I just am interested, you know, for my own curiosity.
And is this something that you've always been interested in growing up?
Yeah, definitely not. Not so much the ghost hunting, because to be honest, I didn't believe in hauntings when I was younger. I believed in life after death. I just didn't think people kind of hung out in a place and caused trouble. I fully was thought that was the stuff of, like, Casper the Friendly Ghost, and that ghosts weren't real. I really thought that. And it's kind of funny to grow up to be an adult, and college I started just kind of as, you know, entertainer as a joke. Went and took a tape recorder and actually captured EVPs. I never thought that I would be going to places where I would see objects moving by themselves and audible voices and all those things that other people might call you crazy for. So, I've always been interested in, mostly though, like I always tell people, in the UFO stuff was what I was reading when I was a kid.
Unfortunately, we only have a couple more minutes. Is there anything, any events or you know, websites you want to pimp out, advertise before we, you know, let you go? Unfortunately.
Yeah. Thanks. Most of everything that is coming up is on benhanson.com, I'm doing, anyone who's out in California, we're, I joined up with the National Foundation for the Arts to encourage people to read. So we're doing a reading, a poetry reading tomorrow of Edgar Allan Poe in Burbank.
That's awesome.
It's fun. It's a lot of fun. And then in October, we're doing some Halloween events, two of them in Utah. I'll be back in Indiana in November for a charity event. And then stay tuned because we're trying to put together a paranormal cruise where we'll be doing some ghost investigating in the Caribbean.
That's awesome.
We were actually talking about doing that a few weeks ago.
Are you actually going to get to any investigating if you're actually there?
Maybe some sharks.
It'll be awesome. It'll be hopefully, you know, a couple hundred people, lectures on board. It'll be the regular cruise experience, seven night cruise, but we'll be scuba diving and doing regular cruise stuff. It's not going to be all paranormal, but at least one of our stops, and probably the hotel we stay in New Orleans, we'll have some ghost hunting.
Nice.
That's awesome.
That's a place to do it.
Yeah, that's a hell of a place to stop for some ghost hunting, that's for sure.
Well, you know, we really appreciate you calling in and, you know, being a part of our show. And it was honestly an honor to get to meet you in Gettysburg at Phenomenology this year. And we're looking forward to hopefully running into you again soon.
Well, thank you. Yeah, I hope to get out to that area and be traveling the country and hopefully making some new episodes for everyone soon.
Definitely. Awesome. So we'll be looking forward and, you know, good luck with everything with Sci-Fi. Hopefully everything pushes through. We can get you guys on for another season and check out some new episodes.
All right. Well, thank you, guys.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, man. Have a good one, man.
Thank you.
Have a good
night.
Bye.
Bye.
That was awesome.
Yeah.
Really cool
guy.
Yeah, he is a nice dude.
Obviously, like, you know, genuine, nice, you know. Just
sounds like he's super busy, too.
Yeah.
You can actually tell when he first called in. Like 10 minutes in, you heard like a horn honking in the background.
Yeah.
I was like, yo, he really is driving right now.
Which we don't promote, obviously.
Yes.
Hands free driving.
He's got all right,
Bluetooth.
Of
yes.
He's a guy who's like everybody else. He drives.
He's into his gadgets.
So, but, you know, if you guys get a chance, you know, check out Ben Hansen, Fact or Faked. He's got a Facebook page, facebook.com/BenHansen00. It's like a fan page dedicated to him and everything. And it's got some of his upcoming events on there as well. And like you said, BenHansen.com. And for more information, check out ShadowsOfTheParanormal.com or Facebook.com/ShadowsOfTheParanormal. So we're going to wrap this one up. Next, you have Your Spirit Beacon with Deborah Nick Lance, all family members, with Rosalind Bound, who was on our show a few months ago. And she's awesome. She was on Ghost Hunters Academy.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and you can listen to that interview on our website,
ShadowsOfTheParanormal.com.
And like all our interviews.
Check out, click the more link, drop down to Misguided Souls, and
But listen to the show, the next show first.
Live.
Yes.
And then listen to it again.
Yeah. Later on us. Yes, exactly.
But listen to Deb's show now, and then listen to us.
It's pretty cool because Deborah and Nick, they're son and mom, and Nick's still up at school, so.
Nicky Poo.
Just started Nicky Poo. So, you know, thank you guys for listening. We'll catch you guys next week on ztalkradio.com. This is Misguided Souls with Shadows of the Paranormal. Have a good night, guys.
Shoals.
My name is Chris Vickers. I've been investigating the paranormal for 3 years.
My name is George Frangomihalos. I've been investigating in the paranormal field now for about 5 years.
My name is Ryan Fessler, and I have been investigating the paranormal for approximately 4 years.
My name is Carolyn Braban, and I've been a paranormal investigator for about 3 years.
My name is Brian Turnoff, and I've been investigating the paranormal for 3 years.
My name is Philip McCarty. I've been investigating for just about under a year.
Being a paranormal investigator means to me is finding the truth.
You know, I don't do this for fame. I don't do this for money. I do this
to help others. That word, paranormal investigator, means responsibility.
It means putting the client first and being able to establish whether a spirit is actually in their homes or not.
Being a paranormal investigator means to me going out and helping someone who needs help that doesn't have explained answers.
My top three favorite places to investigate: number one, Gettysburg, PA; number two, Sac to Coast Manor, Long Island; number three, Mount Misery.
My top three places that I've investigated would be number one, Bobby Mackey's, Wilder, Kentucky; number two, Mount Misery Road in Long Island, New York; and number three, Kings Park Psych Center.
Top three favorite places to investigate would have to be the Fire Island Lighthouse, Kings Park Psych Center, and Sagatose Manor, all located on Long Island.
Best piece of evidence I've gotten has to be at Burlington Prison.
He had a strobe light set up outside the room.
I started to recreate if a prisoner were to get hurt.
And he said, "Guard, guard, help us, we're down."
All of a sudden, strobe light.